Welcome, students, to Monk Meditation, the show about monks in the world of Warcraft.
The beta continues to open up, brewmasters are not getting any more ability cuts, and Windwalker's too slow? Coming up on Monk Meditation, episode 27.
Here's your host, Chai T.
Hello, everybody. A hearty hello to everyone in the dojo and those catching us later. Have we got a show for you tonight? It is most definitely a show of some sort. I'm Chai T, a walker of the wind. Let's go to the master of the brews, Guan Shu. What do you have brewing up tonight, sir?
Oh, not much. Just excited to be back. Haven't talked about monks in a little while. I got a lot of beta play time in when, you know, servers were up.
Yeah.
And I'm excited to kind of talk about it. I even, you know, spoiler, I even went in and played another tank, but I'm not switching. I'm just seeing what's out there.
Don't scare us like that, man.
How dare you, sir?
And that voice is Daikatsu, who's weaving some mists together in a dazzling pattern. What you got for us, sir?
Well, so far, I've got a dog, and I've made a flower. But the problem is, they just disappear too much. That's my only regret.
Yeah, it's because of the wind. Finally traipsing in up on the air up there is air. How's the breeze today, sir?
You are on with the intro today, Chai. That is good. I like that. It's early today in Japan. I don't know why it feels early, but it is early, but it's good. There's coffee. There is walking of the wind, as you said, to be done today. And we gotta bring on some wind talkers later too, I think, don't we?
Yes, we are definitely doing some wind talking today.
We got the wind talkers today.
Alright, well let's check in with tonight's host on how
Storm.
WoW is now.
Whoa. Earth.
Huh. And fire!
And I've got itchy trigger finger, apparently. Alright, I'm gonna start off with the gaze of the Black Prince. It's a lie. It's a horrible, horrible lie.
What?
Game does not want me to play anything but a monk, apparently. I took my druid in, we did all of Throne of Thunder, we did the most of Throne of Thunder on normal. I got two, and then I did, out of the seven bosses I did in Siege, I got one that was the guaranteed one from Pride. All the rest of them were like, nope, 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 nope. So, yeah.
And
yeah,
that's why I don't do a second clone.
You should have said another prayer to RN Jesus.
I know. Apparently, I did not pray hard enough. Well, Rolling Thunder, anyways, is doing good. We got a nice clean kill of a Mercius on Heroic, so that was nice. And we did a few attempts on a Shaun of Pride as well. Got him down to 50% on our second pull, I think. So that's a good progression. So we'll hopefully down him soon. This week, however, we decided we were missing some people, so we went back to Throne of Thunder to get some achievements. I may or may not have completely lost my mind due to catching the golden egg on Jikun. I may have said a string of four-letter words. Finally did it, though, and how? There, I put a video up on Twitter if you guys want to check that out. I caught the egg. Didn't think my priest was going to be able to grab me, so I threw the egg at the priest. Priest grabs me, and I catch the egg. Like a boss. And Durumu, we all hated Durumu back in normal. I still hate him for those that achievement, man. That achievement sucks. The Ghostbuster
reference
is nice.
That's when you gotta like get the extra hidden colors to make purple and gold and like sparkle.
Yeah, you have to cross the beams. Yeah, total pain in the butt. I was not pleased with that. let's see. In the beta, I loaded up a level 100 PvE character. I started trying to do some garrison stuff to get the bonuses they're talking about, and I can't upgrade my garrison. I can't send anyone on missions. So I'm like, all right, I will just go do some dungeons. So queue for a dungeon. Oh, world server's down. And scene. So Duke, how was your time in WoW this week?
You know, there actually hasn't been a lot of time in World of Warcraft this week. I decided that the best course for raid testing last week was to just laugh from afar as the servers went up in flames. And I think I had the best experience overall. overall, it's just kind of quiet. I was out of town this past weekend, so wasn't able to raid on Friday. That's kind of how it's been for me. I've been preoccupied with some other games right now because we're just getting to that part where it's a little on the boring side. And the WoD beta isn't really all that interesting until now, where I can make a level 100 pre-made.
Yeah.
Because I just don't want to spoil myself, and I really, really don't want to play Horde. I really don't.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to getting in there and actually testing some dungeons and whatnot.
Yep.
So,
yep.
Air, how's your week been?
It's been a very fun week. It's been a great week. The raid team, working as intended. We've been together now for about 12 weeks. 14 for most of us, but 12 weeks. This week, we decided to finally do our first lockout. And we succeeded. We downed Heroic Siegecrafter.
Ooh.
In under 40 pulls.
Good job. I know that one held you up before on your previous team.
Mm-hmm. Then, the next day, next raid day, Heroic Siegecrafter, one night, under 40 pulls, down, last pull of the night.
You already said Siegecrafter. Yeah. I think you
I meant Paragons.
Yes. That was Paragons anticlimactic.
Down, yes. The problem with this is, though, is that I did happen to say that if my raid team, if we could pull it together, because we knew we could do it, we had everything, that we just didn't have the right connectivity amongst our minds. If we were able to do it on that last pull, I would, in fact, have a private video of myself dancing the Macarena sent to the team, because it was brought up. And it just so happens, as soon as I mentioned that, we downed him. So, this is something you will not be seeing, Chai.
We'll see.
It's all about motivation.
All about motivation. A big shout out to Mr. Karn, Karn Punch now. He's also our warrior. Because the first time we had a bet like this is I had to give him a transmog for 2 weeks, and that's how we finally got over our spoils hurdle. So, it seems we need proper motivation for our raid team to actually down stuff. But hey, we're on Heroic Garage now.
Yay.
Starting with a farm week, but it's good to go. It's very good. But otherwise, beta, created level 100. I was on a PvP for a little bit. I just didn't have this week has been quite busy. So getting to get back on it as much as possible while the servers are up and play some fast-paced monk action.
Yeah, and yeah. I'm looking forward to that level 100 stuff, so that's good. All right, Guanshu, how's your week been, sir?
A little bit of raiding, but not as a brewmaster. I've actually been windwalkering it for the past couple of raid nights because we're doing our 25-man. Mm-hmm. We're trying to decide who's going to be tanking going into WoD, which my option is I need to tank. But, you know, I did take my turn as a DPS over the last raid night. I was there for the 25 man. You know, I'm not going to be too much of a jerk right now. So I did have to get another cloak, but luckily I wasn't relying on the gaze of the Black Prince. I just went and spent gold on it so that way I could be competitive DPS for the night, which I don't even think helped me all that much because I just haven't played Windwalker enough to do it. I should have had air like in my ear, be like, okay, what do I click next? Yeah, but you know, I had a lot of fun doing something different. But I really like Brewmaster, and not being able to do that over the last 2 weeks on the live server, it's kind of got me down in terms of World of Warcraft because there's not much else for me to do. But I did get on the beta. You know, I created my level 100, ran some of the new dungeons, try and see how it works out. You know, mess around with the talent choices a little bit as well.
All right. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, now to keep your spirits up while the world changes around you, in...
The sky is falling! The sky is falling!
Uplift. Don't worry, I'm sure it happens to other monks too.
Alright, so there was a new beta client that went out. Lots of changes, lots of big changes, but not much for monks. They kind of put us in a good spot, and we're kind of holding steady for right now. Small updates to Tier 16 and the Tier 17 set bonuses. Tier 16 Brewmaster, they changed that because the guard is obsolete. the current four piece is it will guard you when you guard someone else with your statue, but that guard's going away. So they change it to lower the cooldown time on Fortifying Brew, which is boring but still useful. Tier 17, still constant flux, so we're going to kind of skip these changes. All right. Duke, what'd they do for Mistweavers?
Well, they're doing something interesting with Detox by giving you a glyph that gives you two charges of Detox, but it gives you a longer recharge time, a longer cooldown. We don't know how long the cooldown is, but they've been doing something similar with some CC abilities, saying that you can get two charges, but now the cooldown goes from, 8 seconds to 4 seconds of ability. So you might see something where you'll get two charges over 24 seconds cooldown, which isn't bad. If you need to do two quick charges, you've got them there. It all really depends on how long that recharge is, but it's interesting. At least it's not a nerf, and we don't know if it's a buff yet.
Right. It'll depend on the fight. There are some fights where that would become incredibly useful. I can think of like Fallen Protectors. That would be very helpful. Yeah. There's a few other fights like that where I think that'd be really good.
If they even have fights like that. Since it's going to be a glyph, it kind of makes you wonder just how much dispelling is going to be part of it. Is it something that you're just going to have that constantly banked and that's one of the glyphs you don't get rid of? Or is it something you might have an option for if you're short a healer?
Yeah, I mean, imagine there will probably be some fights where there will be a dispel on cooldown. Like, it will match the cooldown. Yeah. So if you take the glyph, you have the larger recharge, and you'll be out a cycle or two. At that point, you'll want to keep it non-glyphed. So at least it gives you an interesting choice.
Yeah.
All right. And Guanxu, something's happened with the Brewmasters?
Well, I don't think it's that something's happening, but it was like the tweet, right? That's what we're kind of talking about a little bit, is at Grafarian, I'm never going to say it, kind of asked to have Brewmaster Monks received all the ability pruning they're going to get. They still seem to have a lot of buttons and redundant skills. Celestalon answered, no more changes planned there, so no. And I agree with Celestalon. We were talking about it before. I don't feel as though we have redundant skills. I went onto beta and live and just kind of spent time like looking, like really like reading every tooltip I could. And I felt there was nothing redundant about anything. And we're kind of a pared down class anyway, seeing as we're the newest class. We don't have, you know, 9.5 years worth of skills getting added constantly. So I just felt like this wasn't really a legitimate concern at this time. It's nice to know Celestalon kind of just straight up said there's no more changes planned. So we can kind of really rely on what we're seeing in the beta in terms of what skills we're going to have to use. So while I'm like spending the time there, my mind's not like, oh, what am I going to lose next? So that was kind of the big thing, I think. The other one was at Weaver J. Humbre asked, are you guys happy with the state of non-DK and Druid tanks? Are not quite a full thing, but he's not, you know, Celestine answered no. You know, he basically wants to bring everybody up kind of where the DK and the Druid tanks have been. And like I said earlier, I kind of spent a little bit of time on a DK tank in the in the beta, just to kind of see if this was true, if it really was a big problem. Because I went in as a brewmaster thinking, oh, we just don't know the fights, that's why we're kind of, you know, wiping so much with a random group, you know, we're not kind of working together. But then I went in as the DK and I felt it was a lot easier. You know, I felt like the DK was actually staying alive easier. And I just literally looked up how a DK tanks and did it. And I've been playing Brewmaster for at least a year now, you know, from switching between them. So I should be able to run this as a Brewmaster pretty easily with a random group and not just be able to pick up a DK and do it a little easier. So that did concern me a little bit at this point. But knowing that Celestalon knows it's an issue, you know, it's a beta. There's going to be changes. I just need to stay calm. And from what I understand, there's a hotline, so if I'm going to really freak out, I can call somebody.
Yeah, I had to go to another show to hear that one, I think.
So, I definitely feel, you know, I'm actually thinking about maybe jumping in as a druid and kind of see how that feels and jump paladin just to try out some more tanking because, you know, Brewmaster is the first time I really tanked in World of Warcraft. So I don't know how they even feel on live at this point, but kind of get an idea of how they feel on the beta might help me to understand, you know, what needs to be done with the Brewmaster to make them better going into Warlords. Because right now I feel fine. you know, I don't feel like gimped compared to like a druid or a death knight or a warrior.
Paladins are fun.
Paladins are fun?
I mean, I have an alt paladin that I've been tanking with, and mm-hmm. LFR and Lex and a couple normals, and it's fun. Yeah. I understand it.
You understand it? I used to heal as one.
So.
I don't think Chai-T realizes he's muted.
No, it probably doesn't.
Yeah, I play a DK tank, and I feel completely indestructible when I play that. So it's... And that's even a low item level, so I don't think it'll be too much of an issue. I'm sure they'll fix tanking. With the higher health values that they're giving players, they have to do something to make tanking more interesting. As if the tank's never in danger of dying, then it's not very fun. So,
yeah, you know what's funny? I have two brewmasters on the beta servers now. I have my regular Pandaren, and then I have a human one now because I want to test out how possible it is to do a versatility build with the brewmaster just for fun, and the human gets the versatility buff from the human spirit now.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I want to give that a shot and see what I can do with just stacking versatility and see how it works. I'm sure it's probably not work all that well, but it's going to be fun. That's what the beta's for, right?
Exactly.
I do like that change that they made to the human spirit racial instead of the other one where you got to pick two and get like a point of each. Now you just get versatility. Feels like the right way for them to go.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's funny. I didn't even know what it was before because I play Horde mostly. Yeah. But then once I saw the change to it, I'm like, oh man, I feel like I need a brewmaster that has that because it's more versatility.
Yep.
Try to min-max a little bit and see if that actually does work. If there's an option for that, I'd love that to be an option.
All right. Well. That was for Brewmaster and Mistweaver. Now it's time for the Windtalkers. It's time now to meditate and expand our knowledge in
Transcendence.
And I am bringing in four wonderful Windwalkers to join us in the call.
Hello. Right.
I think we've got everyone here.
Hello. Some people.
Yes. Okay.
Yes, there are people here now.
So I'm going to introduce our co-hosts for tonight's show. I'm going to start first with Sanch. First time on the show, right?
Yes, it is.
Yay! All right.
So can you tell us which server you're on, what you play, where you are?
Sure. I'm Sargeras, playing Windwalker Monk with Bear Retirement Home.
All right.
I get to Windwalk with Sunnier tanking. So it's a nice little monk combo.
Yes. I love the Brewmaster Windwalker combination. That's why I had Duke switch to tank. All right, and we have also Rotund.
Hello.
Hello.
Good evening.
I think Windwalkers are just fine right now.
Oh God! Run!
On the beta. Hi.
Hi, Rotan. Can you tell us which server you're on and going? Just introduce yourself a little bit?
Yeah, I'm Rotan. I play with I most recently played with Something Wicked on Whisperwind.
All right. And Delritha?
Hello, a.k.a. Hina Lover.
Yes.
Delritha on Kill Jaden with the guild Roadrunners.
All right. And we also have Tiger Crane.
Hi, I am Tiger Crane. I play Tiger Crane on with the Guild of Jantus on Sarfang Oceanic. I am also Daikatsu's Horde Nemesis.
Yes, true.
She sent
me a picture
her.
Of her orc flipping me off on Monday. It was fabulous.
I saw that.
Bravo.
If you have any lore questions, you go to Tiger Crane as well, too, I think.
Okay. All right, and so Celestalon, I want to set this up. Set up this conversation. So we're talking about the concept that Windwalker monks in the beta are slow, as Rotund so eloquently put it. Air, can you go over some of these tweets that we got from Celestalon?
Oh, sure. So Mr. Celestalon, he says, energy classes should generally be energy capped, not GCD capped. Well, So, some replies to that. At Leaflow. On live, I can go 10 minutes with almost no empty GCD. On beta, I already had more empty GCD in less than 2 minutes of testing. Celestalon replies, there's quite a few tiers of difference involved there. That's normal. Leaflow. Blizzard sold us fast-paced Street Fighter style. Celestalon says, people are spreading this idea that Windwalkers are some slow spec now that are as energy-starved. That's not all the case. It's simply not.
All right, so that's the framework. Mm. So we have some people, and this is something I'm hearing a lot, is that Windwalkers feel very slow, and they feel very energy-starved. And Callie couldn't join us tonight. I wanted to get her in because she had an excellent posting on this, how if you're sitting there on the target dummy, and I've done this, it does feel very slow because all of a sudden you run out of energy much quicker. Now, some of this is going to be with weaving in Energizing Brew and Fist of Fury, something that we don't do as much on 5.4. If we weave those in on cooldown and get a little bit better at that, it's going to speed us up a little bit. But I still think definitely slower than what was if you're on target dummy. So we have to see how many bosses include mobilities, movement, things like that, where we will have to move and not be doing DPS to allow our energy to increase, how much that's going to take into effect. So I'm just going to open it up here. Does anyone have any thoughts on this?
I think that especially since 5.4, I think a lot of the problem that people are having are not that it's necessarily a really slow spec now. It's just that we have gotten into that muscle memory of jamming a key every global cooldown. Mm-hmm. You know, of having no global cooldown. So I think it's a little bit slow because I have done primary leveling testing, and there is a very sharp drop off around level 93. And you know, I'm heroic Warforged geared. Sorry, mythic Warforged geared at this point. And that's a really sharp, very sudden decline around 93, 94. But you know, once you get back into the habit of using Energizing Brew, of using Fist of Fury again, it does not feel as bad. Mm-hmm. I think it's not so much that it's a slow spec, but just that the Windwalker community as a whole needs to readjust itself to the new pace.
Yeah.
I would have to agree. I actually spent a good portion of the weekend leveling. Pre-mate only, I didn't copy over my normal tune, but I just went in with a pre-made and just started leveling. And I would say, I have to agree, about 93, 94, it really felt, I can really feel the difference in terms of the speed of the rotation. I was struggling with getting the energy I needed for jabs, but I was weaving in Fist of Fury, Energizing Brew into my rotation, even for these big bosses that show up every so often in the questing environment. But when I was going through testing on the target dummy, I just went in there with full haste build. And I'd say about, the most I could get was about 29% haste. That's with the new haste buff that actually earlier today was confirmed in terms of it providing energizing regen, 5% energy regen. And using Hurricane Strike as my rotation, I've had a few spots where I was struggling with getting energy, but it was almost a consistent energy that I was getting, and it felt almost like I say 5.2 style rotation, where it was every so often you felt a little bit energy starved, but not so much. Not 5.4, but definitely 5.2 feeling. And then on just using my 90 transfers tune, I just did a normal rotation and again felt a few drops, but overall I felt fine with the rotation.
All right, what about you, Sanch?
Okay.
You know, I did some raid testing today, fortunately, and the first boss, there was a lot of mobility time where there was no damage. It was about probably 2 minutes between phases, so that didn't feel nearly as bad as by the time I was really starting to feel it, we were starting to do a movement phase. The second testing I just did a few minutes ago, I felt it more. And one of the challenges is with Fist of Fury is if you get any kind of knockback or anything that interrupts your Fist of Fury, it's dead right away. So when you're counting on that to be a 3 second energy regen and that dies right away, then you're really feeling energy starved until energizing brews back up or something else happens. But in a single target fight with no mobility, it definitely feels slower, but not as bad as I thought it would, I guess.
Were there any knockbacks in the two bosses you tested?
The second one, actually both, yes. The first one has a small stun that goes out for melee if you're not watching it, and the second one drops some boulders that cause some damage and just a lot of mobility in general.
Okay.
I know they've been tweeting about this.
Visual for the stun was not working properly, so once that gets fixed, we can easily move in and out of that.
Yep.
Yeah. Air, what were you saying?
But the stun is staying, is what it is, so they have confirmed that that's a mechanic that we need to look out for. For it being interrupted? Or it's not just a...
We haven't gotten a confirmation on whether if you're getting knockbacked while Fist of Fury that it stops the cast, whether that's intended or not.
Okay, I don't know if I missed anything or not. Okay.
Now, we've asked that question a few times. It's really prevalent a lot of times in the dungeons as well, just the five-man dungeons. A lot of mechanics have some sort of knockback or something causing you, if you're not prepared, to lose that Fist of Fury.
Yeah. The floating butterfly glyph is going to help a lot, though.
Ability buff's going to be useful.
Right?
Yeah. Especially the first boss, where you're just running around trying to in groups trying to kill boxes. Mm-hmm.
Touch of Death is amazing for that.
Yeah. Now I love the boost to Touch of Death. It's great. Rotund.
Probably a little bit overpowered right now, though.
What are your thoughts?
I'm sorry. Oh, yeah. Sorry, you cut out for a second. I think there's two forces at work right going on right now at the beta, and that's why everyone's given the feedback that the spec feels really slow. They did nerf jab, and that's definitely felt. Also, people's gear is not at the item level or not at the not at the end of expansion kind of overpowered like we are right now. So that takes a big hit. I mean, monks have always been very active. Back in Tier 14, we had the Combo Breaker Mastery. It was kind of hard to judge which haste, not which mastery you had to balance. TOT was a little bit slower, and right now it's really fast again. But the beta definitely feels slower than all the tiers we've had so far. And I don't think it's a good... I don't think it's a good way to think of it in terms of... if raid encounters are really movement heavy, then the slowness of rotation gives us time to recover. It's like melee are by design supposed to be very mobile and very active and very like stick to the boss's butt. So
As long as the movement isn't really fast, like faster than we can walk, we should be maintaining our DPS rotation the whole time.
Right, as much as possible. Just have as much time as you can, with staying alive, of course. Don't get yourself stunned and blown up. But so I guess what kind of the focus now has kind of gone away from. I mean, gear is less in your control in this expansion than it has been before. Like you could before move a bunch of stats from haste with reforging or gemming or whatever. I think the bigger focus is going to be on which talents you pick to kind of improve your uptime, improve your stats. So I think as the expansion progresses, we'll move out of more active talents into, as we pick up more gear, as we pick up more haste, we pick up more stats, we'll move into different talents. I think right now Ascension is looking pretty strong. A Chi Explosion is looking really strong right now. And I think if they don't change it, Chi Explosion is going to be the go-to for Windwalkers, going into the first raid tier.
Yeah, I had an interesting discussion on Twitter. I'm not sure if you were in on that as well about Chi Explosion and how for single target fights, you don't really want to pop it at 4 because you're wasting that AoE, but you can't get to 3 very easily.
And that's, I think that's why they... I may be reading tea leaves here, but I think that they slowed down the rotation on purpose so that you're more methodical in how you manage your chi, and I think that's why chi explosion is a... You want to get it just to the right amount and then blow it and not go over. It's kind of like, you don't want to whammy it.
I would like to point this out, and I was having this discussion earlier today, and Rotana can quite in on this. Going for 4 chi or 3 chi is fine. Is because because of our mastery and because of the Tiger Eye brew that we generate from 3 chi, as well as 4 chi for just using 4
using
chi.
Yeah.
We could be generating up to like 4 chi per
explosion.
Yeah, per explosion. Yeah.
Yeah. You don't lose. I mean, you don't lose from spending 4 chi on a chi explosion, and then on an AoE fight, you actually gain from it.
Right.
But you'll be most efficient and most effective spending 3 chi because you'll be generating that extra. 3 chi is where there's that threshold where you get the extra Tiger Eye brew. And that's going to be where, if a good Windwalker can just get the 3 chi and only 3 chi, they'll be doing pretty well.
Yeah, that's just going to be really difficult, except for when we have to use Tiger Palm.
Right.
So. I was kind of forced to use Serenity, I felt today, just to kind of offset some of the energy saps. So when Fitzfury is down, Energizing Brew is down, I can hit that and at least have a chance to also build up energy while doing really good damage and build a lot of stacks in that 10-second window.
Well, I was going Chi Explosion as well as a full Haze build. This was before I had this discussion, and I was at least for the first one of the phase one, I was doing about 21k DPS.
Yeah, which is really hard for us to wrap our head around. It's like, God, that sucks, man.
Were you just standing there? Like, what's going on?
Were you just white hitting the whole time?
But nowadays you're talking about 18 to 22k DPS as average.
Right. All right. So let's move the conversation back to. Go ahead, Tiger King.
That's not being factored into a lot of the target dummy testing, I think, or at least reactions to it. Your pre-made 100s is in greens. You're not going to step into a raid in green gear. I hope you're not going to step into a raid in green gear. You're going to do before you do your first tier boss. You're going to have a bunch of heroic gear. You're going to have heroic weapons, and it's going to probably end up not being as bad as the target dummies are indicating right now. That's something to remember.
Yeah, the difference between greens and purples is quite substantial. And as we get leveled up, I imagine we're going to be back to. I feel that this move, the jab nerf and the combo breaker nerf, was pointed at 6.4. They wanted to make sure we didn't get as crazy as we are now.
Awesome as we are now.
Right. So the first
as
two
RSI
tiers.
As RSI-inducing as we are now.
And I want to point out that, like, even now, you can use energy averaging brew and cooldown. You can use all your GCDs and still have downtime. Like, but it's very minimal. Like, if you stack the heck out of haste, and you're playing your rotation, very very well, you'll have downtime. But it's if introduce any sort of lag and introduce any sort of, like, if you only move your finger so fast, like, you just can't.
Right. It's much more forgiving. It's much more open to other people to pick up the class and be good. Because right now the skill delta is incredibly high, so I'm hoping.
I disagree on that one. I think it's a lot easier to right now go in, level a monk, even just tier 17 LFR gear, pick it up and be good, than it's going to be at the start of this tier in Warlords, because this energy issue, this slowdown, is going to make the rotation a lot more unforgiving. You make a mistake, you hit the wrong button at the wrong time, or you miscalculate, you've lost a lot of your DPS. Tiger Palm falls off, your Rising Sun Kick falls off. And it's going to actually, I think, going to be a lot more punishing for new players or players who may not have the chance to come into beta, test, and become comfortable with this new rotation as it is going to, you know, as it is right now.
It's going to be more forgiving for people like Air, who are have a built-in 200 millisecond lag.
Right. 170 on a good day.
It's going to be a lot more forgiving for that, though, because you can make up that time by getting those button presses in and not losing energy as fast. So it's going to be more forgiving for that. But yes, I understand. I agree that you're still going to be capped on the number of buttons you can hit. And the order that you press those buttons is going to determine the max DPS. And so if you're not hitting the right buttons right, you have less of a chance to correct that. But you have more of a chance to hit buttons now than you did before.
So. And it's more important to know the mechanics of the fight, so you're not hitting like a Fist of Fury or before movement or something else that's going to cause a boss. So really, it's more awareness as well as to be a giant key of it, which today... it's just Blackout Kick and Rising Sun Kick for the most part, so it's not a huge deal if you miss something or do the wrong but the wrong time.
Okay.
For example, during the first test, the only time in which you really need to watch out for your Fist of Fury is moving out of the stun for the first boss, and two, right before he starts doing his roll effect. You're not going to want to do a Fist of Fury when he's rolling away from you.
So I'm gonna go down the line here. So pretty much everyone agrees it feels slower, but not as slow as people are making it out to be, right?
Mm-hmm. Once you get used to it, it's fun.
Once you get over the sticker shock of how, how you go from like 90 miles an hour down to like 15 miles an hour, but. I think you eventually learn how to get around that and how to fill up space.
Okay.
And I think part of that is the fact that when we were first testing this, we had no mods, and so we weren't effectively using our rotation correctly.
Yeah.
Once mods such as like Weak Orders came out, then people were able to this is falling off, I need to do this. This is off cooldown, I need to do this. So on. And so people were able to get more used to the rotation. Then people started going back, it feels slow, but it's not that slow.
Right.
And I think I've been reading that our damage will be compensated, that even if we feel slow, we'll still do the same relative amount of damage as well.
Mm. With us focusing on multi-strike...
Yeah. Well, I mean, right now, Windwalkers play as, Rotund, as you said, like a multiplicative class. You know, we're stacking your Tiger's Eye, we're stacking any kind of smaller percentage buff that we have. Is this something that you're also still seeing now? You guys are still seeing in the beta? Or so
yeah, definitely.
Need to keep track of all that?
Fist of Fury hits much harder than it did. It's going to be...
Oh, yeah.
You're going to have Fist of Fury... Well, just on procs basis, like, Tiger Strikes is really important. Proc right now, so you want to stack that up with your Tiger Eye Brew, you want to stack that up with the Fist of Fury, you want to use Rising Sun Kick, you want to kind of like throw all those things in the same window and just have make sure you're kind of making the stars align when possible.
Yeah, Tiger Strikes is going to be another thing that we have to throw into our weak auras, another thing to track.
Oh yeah.
Now, is this going to be something that we have to pay more attention to compared to live?
Tiger Strikes just happens and it's icing on the cake, but it's kind of one of our. I hate to go back to the Roro analogy, but it's potent and it happens at random intervals. So
okay,
yeah. If all the stars align, you have your Tiger Eye Brew ready to go. You've got your and as soon as that Tiger Strike pops up, if you got a Trinket proc and you have your Fist of Fury up, you just got to be quick and like hit everything and go.
So something like this essentially plays well with a slower.
Also keep in mind. If you're doing that and you're doing an Energizing Brew and a Fist of Fury, you are going to energy cap, which, except for Serenity, is generally a bad thing.
Right, yeah, I'm not even saying using Energizing Brew, but yeah, that's kind of a cooldown. But Tiger Strikes kind of takes place of that for the most part. You get that extra bonus multi-strike, so it's like Tiger Strikes pops up, and you hit your energizing brew, yep. not energizing brew, Tiger Eye brew, and then Fist of Fury, and you're going to hit like a Mack truck. It's going to be fantastic.
Yep.
Now,
so we're playing slower, and we're playing. We have to pay more attention to our little buffs
right.
like that.
Right.
Yep.
We have another one to track now.
We're essentially going to turn into what affliction locks are right now.
Right.
I mean, we're just going to have to watch for a lot of really short-term, quick buffs, and you know, we're just going to have to play that way. Good thing we're not going to live and die by Tiger's Eye Brew. Bad thing is that I think what's going to throw most players for a loop more than the slowdown is the slowdown on Tiger's Eye Brew. Because that's, you know, we're used to hitting that all the time, you know, having it almost all the time whenever you want it, and having to actually plan ahead significantly for your Tiger's Eye Brew use, or actually just make the decision, you know, do I want to use this right now with this short-term buff, or do I want to wait till my tiger strikes are up?
And this hasn't...
You know, I think that's what's going to hit players the most, not the slowdown.
Has this been added into the beta yet? I know the last build it still wasn't in, with the 4 versus 6.
It's still in. It's still 4.
Still 4. Okay, is it going to go up?
Not that I've heard.
Okay.
Was
that just a tooltip bug that we've been looking at the whole time?
I'm assuming it's going to go to 6 because it's been asked a lot what the heck, you know, what is this correct, and we haven't heard yay nor nay.
Yeah. But it hasn't. The tooltip has been there for the last.
I'm going to caution say that it will go to 6.
It's been there for like the last 4 to 6 builds, and yet it hasn't updated, so I'm thinking it's a bug. I don't know. Well, I guess we'll have to find out.
I think 6 will feel really slow.
Yeah.
I think we should keep talking about it like it's 6 and just keep it under our
right.
hats that it's really
right.
4.
And then when we get 4, we're like, yeah, praise be Celestalon.
Just like the roll and the flying serpent kick. It does not turn. It's totally fixed.
Oh, God, yep. I love that.
Working as intended.
Yep. Working as intended.
Working as intended.
All right. Sanch, I'm going to go down the line here. So twofold question here. What does this need to be fixed, and if so, what needs to be done to fix it?
Would I like to be fixed? Yes. Does it need to be? I think it makes you more strategic and hopefully a better player when you're not just bashing buttons. But I would love to see probably 45 energy for a jab versus 50. I think that would make enough difference where it's still not nonstop every GCD, but not the downtime that we are still seeing now without just full haste builds.
Okay. And Rotund?
Yeah, I mean, I think 45 is a good number. Those guys said, like, leveling on the beta, you start to hit that knee point around level 93, and you start feeling it a lot more. I think, you know, lowering the floor a little bit would help, like, everyone kind of ease into it, get used to it. So by the time they're level 100, that level 100, it'll be playable, and we'll still have plenty of breathing room, so we don't hit this GCD capping issue that we're having right now by the end of the expansion.
All right, and Delretha?
45 is probably the only thing I would actually go for. Everything else about the spec feels fine. Changing up the stat priority for just our level 100 talents, having that option. Rotund was suggesting that Chi Explosion will be using more mastery for that build than we are than Hurricane Strike or Serenity. And basically having two sets of gear for our talent choices. Other than that, yeah, I would say the only thing is 45 energy.
Okay. All right, and Tiger Crane?
You know, just to be different, I'm going to say that the 50 energy cost is not a problem. I feel that, like, just going and seeing, like, just seeing the stat change that people get, like, the eye level buff in the raids, I think that the slowdown is going to be transitory, and it's going to be just a part of the growing pains that we're going to have at the start of any expansion, that any energy class has at the start of an expansion. And I think, like, definitely if the theory is right that they're aiming these nerfs at 6.4, then by the time we get to 6.4, you know, 50 energy is going to be a drop in the bucket.
Mm-hmm. And just like it is now. Like a Mack truck. It's going to be fantastic. All right, Air, what do you think?
You know, I haven't been able to spend as much time as a lot of you guys have on the beta, but, you know, leveling up, if you're really just pounding at stuff, it does feel a little bit slow. But if you're bringing over a character, like when I transferred my character over, stuff was dying so quickly you couldn't tell anyways.
Right.
In a couple dungeons I was able to run, you have to really pay attention. This is without add-ons, too. That it just becomes a bit of a cluster bang to kind of keep that all tracked up. But you know, I'm hoping that the class still can maintain some of its prior glory with the GCD craziness, because that's a really fun style to play. Yeah. And I'm like looking at the numbers, looking at what people are saying, I'm thinking like the 45 does sound like it would fix a little bit. And it's something that they could always, I mean, if we're really that bad, they've changed us mid-expansion in the past.
Several times.
So why mess with it? What they've already done, you know?
Right.
We used to have a new master all the time. Why not give us new energy here and there, you know? Rebalance us whenever, because it's what they already do. So, you know, we're used
as long
to
as
that,
they,
right? We're,
as long as they don't give us back the TOT two-piece where you have to chase little yellow balls all over the place.
Yeah.
Forgot about that.
And the collective sigh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whenever I ran over that one, it was a happy accident and nothing more.
And you're usually already high on energy anyways.
Mm-hmm.
So we got the gray ones here, the green ones here, and the yellow ones here. So okay, now I need this one, now I need this one.
And if you're colorblind, you're like, I don't know what's going on.
Well, they had different sizes.
Get a mist weaver and a wind walker, and you know, just get all three specs and you have a ball pit.
Yep.
Yep. Skittles.
Well, at least they're changing the colors for all the balls.
Yep. So I'm of the opinion that I think we're going to be just fine. I think 50 energy is going to be in a good spot. I like the fact that we're going to be hitting so much harder with our focus on multi-strike. I think it's definitely going to feel slower, but I think our damage will compensate just fine, so I'm A-okay with it. So I would like to thank everyone for joining us. Thank you so much. For those that like the cut of these Windwalkers jib, you can follow them on Twitter. Sanch can be found at SanchWow. Rotund can be found at Brotund. Delritha can be found at HinaLover. And Tiger King can be found at AshViridian. All right, thank you guys for joining us.
Not a problem.
All right, take care.
Windtalkers!
Yes, Windtalkers for the win. All right, it's time now to travel to the Peak of Serenity, the home for all monks in
Zen Pilgrimage.
Monks, assemble!
Hey, Duke and Guanxi, you guys awake?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Huh? Why?
Before we go on, I just want to point out that in our chat room at the very beginning, Karn, you know, longtime friend, someone I great monk, someone I've raided with for a while now. He did want to say that Broten, if the Windwalker changes stay, needs to change his name to Slowtund. So, credit to Karn for that one. And I feel bad that was missed when he was actually on.
Yes, that would have been good to put it there. All right.
Can I ask AR a question?
Yeah.
I actually have a quick question for you. And this, it's funny because it's not actual like gameplay based, but it's like, I guess, story based, you know, RP based, and I'm not an RP or anything, but as a Windwalker, or as playing the Windwalker and kind of knowing obviously the monk class, I like the more deliberate, slower attacks in terms of just style, opposed to the fast and furious. Am I like one of the only people that feel as though that fits a monk more than a fast and furious attack? I know that everyone's like, oh, Street Fighter fast attacks, but I kind of like slow, deliberate, you know, thinking of your attacks before you do it kind of monk style.
It's that definitely makes a lot of sense, but when you're doing a very fast and furious playstyle, if you make a mistake, it does affect you quite a lot. So you have to have that really kind of zen. You get that flow when you're doing your rotation, when you're getting things down, and then you're hitting every button just right, and you're not You know, you're like, up, Fist Fury, perfect timing. After that, Energizing Brew, perfect timing. Up, here's a Combo Breaker, weave that in. My four-piece just activated, weave that in. When you get all that, it's just like a dance. It's a wonderful monk dance. And when it's done well, it shows. I mean, then you're up there in that upper echelon of where you need to be to help get bosses down, which is really fun. I think that the changes then, yeah, the idea of being a little more contemplative with seeing, what do I hit now? Okay, this is up. I must do this. Now I must do that. And now I have a little bit more energy. I can do this. It definitely fits, but...
But it's more fun.
I totally understand what you're saying, but yeah, I do have a lot of fun, and the fact that it does take that quick reaction time, that quick thinking, I think is very, very fun.
Okay. I was just curious.
I think both ways are going to be fun.
I personally think it's the split between people who thought Yoda at the end of episode 2 was perfectly fine and people like me that thought he looked like a retarded monkey.
He looked great. Yoda was awesome. Exactly what you would expect a Jedi Master to be able to
do. I went back to Sonic see that movie just for that scene again the second time.
See, I always expected Yoda to be like one hit and be done. He didn't have
to. Yeah. It's like, no, instead he decides he's just going to Sonic the Hedgehog all over the room. Bum, 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 slash.
You use the environment to your advantage.
That doesn't mean walking up a wall.
All right, well, let's get the Mistweavers back in because we're losing the dojo, I think. At Kirby T. Pink asks on Twitter, what do you think of the Mistweaver mastery at the moment and its changes in Warlords of Draenor?
Has it changed?
The mastery is going to be the same, but the use of mastery is going to be very different.
Yeah, I actually think mastery is probably going to be a little bit better for us, especially with the fact that now if the ball explodes, you get the full heal instead of only half heal, right?
Mm-hmm. And we can trigger our own.
And yeah, detonate chi is going to be amazing, especially on some fights where you might just stack up all in a little spot. So I think you're going to see more Mistweavers take mastery and possibly even like it, maybe even over haste, considering that we still only have one spell that really benefits from haste.
There was another change to the Mistweaver that I forgot to mention in Uplift. The passive ability, was it Path of Mist?
Right.
No, level 100 talent?
Mm-hmm.
It's no longer passive. It's active. It will cost mana, and it will cost more mana the longer you hold it.
Hmm.
Yeah, it's like 1,000 to activate and 2,000 every second after that. And I haven't done much testing, but there doesn't seem to be an upper limit until you just run out of mana.
Right. And so you'll want to activate it as you start moving. And so that way, I think they're doing that just for less spell clutter. So you don't just have balls everywhere. Where they're not even needed. Like if you're moving between boss locations, all the ones you left behind you are going to be absolutely useless. But if you need it, if you're running ahead of the group, you can activate it, drop them, and they can run through them or something. So
for those Durumu mazes, it's a real nice.
Oh, Durumu would be perfect use for that one. Yeah. All right. So Mistweaver Mastery, yeah, 5.4. I agree with Duke. It's don't give me mastery, don't want it, don't need it. But in WoD, I think
we might actually like mastery a bit.
It's not going to be the case where it is now, where it's like, oh, that's got spirit mastery, I don't want it, go ahead and shard it.
Yeah.
Now it's going to be spirit mastery. I'm like, there. Right.
I think crit is still going to be king and by a mile, but I think you're going to see people taking a very small amount of haste comparatively to what we do now, mainly because mastery is going to be useful both in Crane and Serpent's Dance, whereas haste is not really as useful as it is in Serpent's Dance, in Crane's Dance as it would be in Serpent's Dance.
Right.
While crit is just amazing in both.
Right, and don't forget multi-strike. So it's like, if I see a multi-strike, if I see multi-strike mastery, I'll take it.
Yeah.
I prefer multi-strike crit, multi-strike versatility, maybe, but I would take...
And you're probably going to have no more than 3 or 4 pieces with spirit on it, and probably those same 3 or 4 pieces with haste.
Yep. All right, and at Fingus Roberts asks, Brewmaster damage intake. Is this going to be a rude awakening for people used to over gearing?
You know, honestly, I think they still need to tweak the damage in the beta, obviously, because it's always in flux and we're taking a lot of damage. I think for people who are just really over geared, it will be kind of an awakening, because at least how it feels now is you're taking a lot more damage. But I don't find that people that I know that are over-geared are relying on being over-geared, because they're good players. You know, does that make sense?
Right.
You know, so the people that are over-geared are the good players, and they're over-geared because they were able to do it while they were under-geared.
You've also got a case where you have a lot of people who are boosting a monk and coming into this world with 489 gear.
Mm-hmm.
So you kind of feel like, yes, I can smash. Keg smash is awesome at the beginning.
Yes, it's awesome now too, but I don't know. We're going to have to see how much damage is coming in once it releases, or maybe later in the beta. As when I was on the DK, I felt like I was taking a lot less damage at that point. So I think it's a matter of General Zod has been saying kind of a couple times, saying armor scaling is off and the guard is still bucked. So we're going to have to wait to see all that stuff kind of falling out in the beta before we can really make a 100% answer to that.
I'm not going to say it's not a valid question, but it's not a question that needs to be asked right now. We still have number tuning to be done. We still have bugs in armor scaling. We still have bugs in guard. We're coming in at really low item level green gear. You're not going to be raiding in that. So right now, brewmasters are taking a crap ton of damage. It's like if you pop in on your 483 green gear and your boosted monk and then jump straight into Siege of Orgrimmar Flex, you're going to get stomped. So it's going to be something where you need to take it with a grain of salt. Right now, it doesn't feel great, but once it's tuned and once you actually get the gear you're going to need, I don't think it's going to be nearly as bad, but we'll have to see. We'll have to see how it is. It is going to be very different from someone who comes in right now and gets really good gear and is feeling invincible. And then they get to 100 and it's going to be back to tier 14 where you're getting raffle stomped at the beginning. So it will be a rude awakening. I think that's right, but it won't be quite as bad as we think it is.
Mm-hmm. No, but more than it has been every expansion.
Right.
Exactly.
That's well, we've only had every one expansion so like far that. To deal with wow. it. But. All right. I want to talk about the All Monk Flex. This happened last week. So for those who didn't see it, Gulvin and Aleva both did some commentary. They had both streams going. They were following both teams, and I was giving commentary on it. And I'll include the links in the show notes so you can check that out on YouTube. So the results were...
They were absolutely awesome, by the way. I have to say that their stream, their commentary was just top-notch.
Yes, they did a very good job. They had a light and a lot of good commentary. I want to definitely give a shout out to both of those guys for doing it. So unfortunately, it didn't feel like a fair fight. The Horde, the leader who was on last time, Brandon, he contacted me the morning of, and there was a family emergency and he couldn't make it. So our second place person, we were going to take over Jade Dot, who went back to the Horde. After been on the Alliance for a while, I was like, okay, can you take over? She's like, I actually had to back out too for something. So I'm like, all right, 2 hours before we start. And I'm like, who wants to lead? And Hina Lover and
Tiger King.
Tiger King was kicking butt, but she wasn't leading.
Ken Jin was someone that.
Yeah, he was one who took that over and really helped.
Yeah.
So they put together the best team they could, but unfortunately they had 16 people sign up.
And they didn't get started until 40 minutes into it?
I think it was about 20 minutes.
They were like, at the start, at like the official start of the race, they had six people.
Four.
Oh, wow.
They had four people. They had four. Yeah. Out of 16 players, four showed up. So they had to pug a lot of people, and so they didn't have a very cohesive team. So they did very well under the circumstance, but Alliance completely destroyed them. So our full clear.
It's, it's, It's not a victory. It's just a win.
Yes. Yeah, I will so still.
It's that hordes, you know, horde people sticking together, you know, that they're all about, and
right.
You know what? You know, let's do it on a non-Saturday, and I'll take the lead on the horde side, and then we'll see what happens.
All right, so we're doing it every Saturday.
So J-Dot and I are actually talking about this. We are planning on putting together a 10v10. That was the other thing, is they finally got started, and they had 10 people. We had almost a full 25. And so you had that 25 versus 10 thing, where Immersius, we just melted Immersius right away. They had a little bit longer because they had to deal with getting the spread out. And so we're working together and putting a chosen 10-man team. We're gonna play playground captain again. I'm like, I choose you, I choose you, I choose you. And we'll put together a strike team and go head-to-head again. So, and we'll try to do it on Sunday this time for you, Quanchu.
Yeah.
All right. So our full clear on Alliance side, we did fantastic. We wiped only twice the entire time. And we went 2 hours, 36 minutes, 52 seconds. We wiped once on Thok, which I was surprised about. That's only because we decided to one tank it. We went risky and we midwintered it.
Yep.
So the second time we went two tanks and we melted it just fine. And then we wiped once on Gary, but then we downed it on the second time. So the team we put together was fantastic. Everyone who joined on the Alliance side was really, really good. So we cleared it, and then the Horde cleared the third wing, and they were about 6 minutes behind us, and they decided, I don't think we can really down Gary in 6 minutes. So they decided to just call it there.
Fair enough.
So it was a good fight, but we hope to have a better fight next time. I'd love it if we got to Garrosh like at just about the same time. That would just be fantastic. So, all right. I think that does it. I think it's time to put the brew away. But first, let's check out the 5-star reviews. And I'm checking them now, and they're not there. So please rate us on iTunes, Stitcher, subscribe on YouTube, or on Twitch.tv. All right, Air, you have any shout-outs?
I do. So this last week, we had some vacation time coming up with some raid members. So I put out on the call in the Twitterverse that we were looking for a couple players to help plug in. And shout-out to Sanch, because he hooked us up with a friend of his, Valk, played the awesome DK, helped us get through our farm night, and it got up some loot, which is great. But yeah, 1 3.5-hour night, farmed all the way up and through Heroic Thok, so that was our best night ever. We really needed that, and that's what set us up for our Siegecrafter and Paragon skill.
Fantastic. Is that Valkalir or Valkarir or something?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's raided with us quite a few times on Rolling Thunder, so he's he's a real-life friend of one of our raiders, so he's a great guy. All right, Guanchu, got any shout-outs?
My guild, as usual, Inconceivable. It's been, fun kind of playing, doing some 25-man. I'm looking back to getting back to Brewmaster on the rotation we're up to. I haven't said this since I think I've been on the show. If anyone really wants to hear me kind of talk about Heroes of the Storm, I do a Heroes of the Storm podcast as well called The Nexus, which we record every Friday night at 10 Eastern time. You know, come and check that out. Kind of talk about a whole different game, which still doesn't have Chen Storm Stout. I feel lied to and cheated at this point.
Blizzard, how dare you?
I feel the same way about Hearthstone.
Yeah. I want my monk deck now.
Yeah, but you guys didn't have to stare at like Chen Stormstout
on the loading screen the whole
months
time.
On the loading screen.
We can't get a monk deck in Hearthstone, otherwise everyone would be playing that.
Right.
Well, then we have Miracle Rogue.
Well, in Hearthstone, yeah. I would play a monk. Here.
Basically, it's Miracle Rogue is monk.
Yeah. All right, Duke, you got any shoutouts?
Shout out to Bungie for putting out a hell of a fun game that's absorbed me for the last couple of weeks, because dear God, Destiny is a lot of fun.
September
just to put things in perspective,
time.
I have paid for the $90 digital version. I have yet to buy Warlords of Draenor.
Yeah, I am actually in the same boat. I have not pre-ordered yet.
Yeah, I haven't pre-ordered. Draenor. I'm going to. Mm-hmm. It's just I don't want to have that pressure of that, hey, boost to 90 constantly there, because I have no idea what the hell I'm
going to boost. Yeah, me neither. I have no idea what I'm going to boost.
Second shout out to all of the monks out there that are currently in the beta and understand the sky is not really falling and not saying bad things to the developers, because, guys, the beta hasn't ended yet. Calm down.
Point that out again.
Be respectful.
Yeah. Beta hasn't ended yet. Calm down. Yes. Absolutely. All right. I want to give a shout out to all of our great guest Windwalkers. You guys are fantastic. To Gulvin and Aleva for their commentary on the Flex, and the fantastic group of 25 raiders that joined us for the All Monk Flex to help kick the Horde's butt, put them in their place. And Naoyuki has a shout out as well for Inamonami Enterprise, downing heroic shamans and heroic Nazgrim. Congratulations to them. All right, as part of the Monk community, if you have a blog, website, or person you want to see on the show, reach out to us via email at show@monkmeditation.com. Monk community is the best one in the World of Warcraft, and we want to showcase it. Duke, how can the dojo best reach us?
Well, you can find the show at monk_meditation on Twitter. Chai T can be found at WowMonk. Naoyuki is at Naoyuki_CTR. Air is at AirWalker. I can be found at DaikatsuCTR, no underscore. Guanchu is at GeekOfRandom. And LeBlue is at Kagurai_LeBlue.
All right, I want to thank all of you for listening. You can watch us live Monday, August 11th at 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, 100 UTC at twitch.tv/WowMonk. You can also visit monkmeditation.com for links to all the ways to watch and listen to the show. Monk Meditation is part of Catalyst Gaming Media. For other great gaming blogs, podcasts, and events as World of Podcasts approaches, visit catalystgamingmedia.com. That wraps up this episode of Monk Meditation.
May your brews be strong and your heart stronger.
Night, everybody.